We will work on two things. One is obviously absolute values and inequalities, and others is limit continuity and differentiability. And all of this basically you know from your high school days, you have studied all of this. So whatever we are going to do, we are going to look at some of the properties and just review the concepts. Okay, so let's start. So the first result that we start with about inequalities, that inequalities are transitive. Okay. They follows transitivity. Now, what does that mean? That is, if A is greater than B and B is greater than C, then A is greater than C. Now, from our middle school days, we also know that equalities are also transitive. Equalities are also transitive. Hence, you can write this, if A greater than equal to B and B greater than equal to C, then A greater than equal to C, right? Okay. All right, now we'll look into the rules of arithmetic operations. So rules of arithmetic operations, basically how they behave under addition, subtraction, so on and so forth. Okay. Okay, so the rules are pretty simple and you know the rules also. So about number one is about addition and subtraction. Addition and subtraction. In that we know that A greater than B implies A plus minus K greater than B plus minus K, right? Okay, where K is okay, it's not that not racer, but yeah, let me write it, where K is a constant. Although that's not really necessary. I mean, you can minus some z also, which is a variable. So, okay, let's remove that. In general, that holds true. Okay, now the second is obviously multiplication and division. Multiplication and division. And in that, we have A greater than B implies, so it will be KA greater than KB when K is positive, and it will be KA less than KB when K is negative. Okay. So the whole thing revolves around the fact that whatever you are multiplying, whether it is positive or negative, that's what matters. Okay, now we'll go to another one, which is squaring. Okay. So number three is so now squaring. In squaring, the rule is pretty simple. It is A greater than B. And now, this is a huge condition, B greater than equal to 0. Without this condition, the whole thing will not work. So A greater than B implies A squared greater than B squared. a square greater than b square. Okay, now if I take b greater than equal to 0, and if I say a strictly greater than b, that basically means a is also positive, right? So this condition basically implies that both of them are either, the lower one can be 0, but if that is not true, then both of them are essentially positive. Or if I say strictly, none of them is non-negative. Okay, so that's a very important condition, and that can be stated only by making b greater than equal to 0. All right. So now we'll go to another area where the idea of inequalities we use quite heavily, and that's in the notation of an interval, whether it is closed or open. Right? So if we try to draw any certain interval on a real line, it will appear as an interval. Okay. So when the domain, when the domain of X is an open interval, open A comma B, this implies basically A strictly less than X, strictly less than B. Right? And for closed interval, if I say that X belongs to close A comma B, then it basically means A less than equal to X less than equal to B. So that's how intervals are connected. Now we come to absolute value. Okay. So in absolute value, we are going to consider this. So consider an open interval to which X belongs as open minus A comma A. Okay. So, and say A equal to 10. So that means what? That means we are saying that X belongs to minus 10 comma 10. Now this is a scenario which can be represented as this: mod X less than 10, right? So see, if this interval can be represented by absolute value also. So this is the essential role played by the use of absolute value. And the obvious important part is this less than sign. So because X belongs to minus 10 and 10, we can also write it using absolute value modulus symbol. Okay, so how do we read it? We read it as modulus X. Modulus X, okay. So now, analytically speaking, if I want to define a modulus function, how will I write it? So analytically speaking, for any real number X, mod X is equal to X when X is greater than 0. And obviously 0 when X is equal to 0. And then minus X when X is less than 0. Okay, so this is the analytical definition of mod X. And it is always a good idea when we have a problem involving modulus x, it is always a good idea to use this definition, break down the modulus function into simple functions, and then proceed. Okay, that's how you should do it. And one of the thing that you must be always taking care of the fact that let's say this is, we are talking about mod x. Now for mod x, zero becomes an important point, right? Because as you can see that on the, depending on zero, the sign of x changes. So for example, if I'm dealing with something like a modulus x minus one, then this function actually will, if I go by the analytical definition, then basically, just to give you an example, if I have something like mod x minus one, then this analytical definition tells me that mod x minus one is x minus one when x minus one is positive, which makes it x greater than one, and zero when x minus one equal to zero, which makes it x equal to one. And the last one is minus of x minus one when x minus one is negative, that is x less than one. So what do we see? What we see is that not always it is true that the value will change based on zero. It depends on the modulus function. And only when you can, if you analytically write it, you will find that integer or that number, or in general, it can have a modulus function will have more than one points of change. So for example, I can consider something like this also, mod x plus mod x minus one. So for this one, I have zero and one, 2 points, okay? So with practice, you'll be able to look at it and find out which at which point the function is changing its slope, let's say, or changing its nature. Okay, and those are the points we must be very concerned about when we'll be dealing with limit continuity and differentiability related to absolute values. Okay, so let us proceed. Now, in general, what you can write is that in general, mod x less than equal to some k is implies and implied by minus k less than equal to x less than equal to k. Okay, that is more like a rule. So you can easily guess what happens if I make this less than inequality to be greater than. It will change, right? Okay, so now let's look at some of the properties again, which are related to arithmetic operations, that is addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. Okay, so number one is that mod m plus n is greater than or equal to mod m plus mod n. Now this is quite easy to see, because if you take, let's say, m equal to 3 and n equal to 2, then it implies that mod m plus mod n is equal to 5. And also mod m plus n is equal to 5. But the scenario changes if I take m equal to 3, but n equal to minus 2. So in that case, mod m plus mod n, I have written the opposite thing. Mod m plus mod n greater than equal to mod m plus n. Yeah, so if I do mod m plus mod n, then again it is m 5. But if I perform m plus n, then this becomes basically mod of 3 minus 2, which is 1. So it is because of that, the higher side will obviously on where I add the absolute values taken separately. Okay, then comes number two, which is mod m into mod n equal to mod m into n. Then third one, which relates to division, so m divided by mod m divided by mod n is equal to this. Okay. All right. Now let us solve two easy problems of inequality. So simple problems on inequality. Okay, so how to find the method, so to say, is pretty simple. The solution, if it exists, because in mathematics, that is the central first problem that it deals with. So if it exists, is a set of values of x which make the inequality a true statement. A true statement. So it is that simple. Technically speaking, the solution style obviously follows the path of other solutions that we do. It's just that with inequality, you end up most of the time with not a single number, but an interval. That's the only possible difference. But otherwise, it's simple. Okay, so number one, which we'll take, it's pretty simple. So solve 3x minus 3 greater than x plus 1. So what do we do? So I have 3x minus 3. So first, what we do is plus 3, which makes it x plus 4. And this becomes 0. Then I subtract an x, right? So that basically makes this 2x greater than 4 and x greater than 2. Okay. So what is my answer? My answer is basically, obviously, x greater than 2. That's correct. But if I want to write it as an interval, this interval will be x belongs to open 2 comma infinite. Okay, just if I want to write it as an interval. Okay, and obviously always check for whether you are dealing with a strict inequality or a weak inequality, because that is a very common point of making a mistake. Let's go to another one, which is to solve modulus 1 minus x greater than equal to 3. Now, using what we studied, right, this basically, let me write it like this, 3 less than equal to mod of 1 minus, okay, there is no need of that. No, it's fine. So we can directly actually write from that keeping in mind that mod x less than equal to 10, what we stated is that minus 3 less than equal to 1 minus x less than equal to 3. Okay. So it basically means if I subtract this 1, so it will be minus 4, it will be minus x, and this one will be 2. So, okay. And from that, If I want to go to positive side from the negative side, basically I'm multiplying with minus 1 and making it from negative to positive actually changes the inequality. So minus 2. And by that, I have my answer, which is minus 2 less than or equal to x less than or equal to 4. And then again, if I want to write this as an interval, then I have x belongs to, and we have weak inequality here. So closed interval, closed minus 2, comma 4. Okay. So these are the basic things that you can handle with involving something like inequality and also modulus.